So in this job, we are going to try to prove that the intersection of subgroups is a subgroup. Now, would you know what intersection of subsets means? What's the definition of intersection for subsets?
If an element is in the intersection of a subset of...
Yeah,
of
what is that?
Two sets, and what? Then the element is in both sets.
Yeah, so it's the things which are in all the sets. Okay? But now you can do intersection not just for two sets, but for infinitely many sets, any number of sets. Okay? If you're not comfortable with infinite stuff, you can just assume we are working with intersections of finitely many things. But we're not actually using anything but finitely. So I have a group, and I have a bunch of subgroups. Now, usually if there's only finitely many, I might call them H1, H2 to HN. Right? But now there could be infinitely many. So instead of saying H1, H2 to HN, I'm using some labels here downstairs, this I, the subscript, but then the I need not be on varying from 1 to N. It's just varying over some indexing set. Okay, if it's the finite number of things I'm trying to talk about, then I'll just use the indexing set as 1 to N. Okay? But if it's like countably infinite, I could just use all the natural numbers. But if it's much bigger, I could use something else. But you can just think of it like H1, H2 to HN, if you want. Okay? Though everything I say works for infinite intersection. So, and let's say all of these are subgroups of G. Then what I want to show is that if I take the intersection of all of these, which means I'm looking at the elements of the group which are actually in each of the sets. Right? I'm looking at an element. An element is in the intersection if it is there in every subgroup. And I want to show that this intersection is also a subgroup of G. Okay? Now there's a little convention which you should get used to, which is that if you have an empty intersection, that means you are intersecting, but there's nothing to intersect. Okay? You're trying to take an intersection over an empty set, then it's just taken to be the whole set. Have you seen that?
The intersection of what?
The intersection of nothing. So if there's nothing to intersect, I'm intersecting two things or three things or five things or one thing or something, right? If the number of things I'm trying to intersect is zero,
Okay. Then
it's just into the whole group. It's like the way we say an empty product is considered one or an empty sum is considered zero.
Okay.
The same way an empty intersection is considered to be the whole set.
Okay.
Okay, good. So now I want to prove that the intersection of subgroups is a subgroup. Now what's the definition of subgroup that you have in mind?
Subgroup? It itself is a group.
So it's a subset?
Of a group.
Yeah, and what should be true relative to the big group?
It has the same identity element of...
Well, it has the same multiplication. Mm-hmm. So it's closed under... Okay, so let me just write down the two definitions, then you tell me which one's better for our purpose. Mm-hmm. Okay, so one definition says... subgroup equals subset closed under the multiplication becomes subgroup under that, becomes a group under that. The other definition says subgroup is a subset closed under all three operations. So remember, there were two ways to think of the definition of group, right? One was you just say there's a multiplication operation, it satisfies some condition. The other was you put three operations as part of the structure. And now there's two definitions of subgroup. One corresponds to the first definition of group and the other corresponds to the second definition, where you say it's closed under multiplication, identity and inverses. And these are actually the same definitions. And the reason is that you can show that if the subset has an identity and inverse, it has to be the same as the identity and inverse in the whole group. Now, which definition do you want to use for this proof?
The second one.
The second one? Yes, that's the right one to use. And the reason is that it's a lot easier to just show that the identity and inverse of the group are there in the intersection than to try to figure out what the identity is and inverses in the subset should be, right? So it's a lot easier just to say, it's closed under all three operations. Okay, so we're going to try to prove that the intersection is closed under all three operations. identity, inverses, and multiplication. We can do them in any order. Okay. So, the proof will have, you have to show three things, right? What are the three things you have to show? So, let's call it H. So, let H be this intersection. So, what are the three things you have to show? It goes under the multiplication, identity, and inverses. Okay. We can do them in any order. So, let's begin by showing that the identity is an H. Well, what do we know? Well, it's an intersection of a bunch of things. And we know that
each subgroup has the identity.
Yeah. So we know that E is an HI for each I. For all I in I. So E has to be an H, right? So E has to be in the intersection. Right? If an element is there in every subgroup, it has to be in the intersection. Right? Okay, now let's do the second one. So, I'll now use G. I've been using A, B, C, X, Y, Z in previous videos, but I'll just use G. That's how people typically write group letters, G. Right? So, I want to prove that G in H implies G inverse in H. How do I do that?
G in H implies G in every HI, and then implies G inverse in every HI, and then implies G inverse in H.
Yes, I skipped a step. So this just means that's the next step, yeah. In the intersection. So there's nothing here. I wrote the inverse, which is correct, but I sort of skipped a step. So G is an H, means G is in each HI, which means G inverse is in each HI, which means that G inverse is an H. Okay, and what's the last thing we want to show? It's closed under what? So we want to show that G and H in H, which could be equal, right? When I write like this, I allow them to be equal. Implies GH is an H. How do I show that?
It's the same logic.
G comma H is R in H. Implies G comma H R in HI for all I in I. Implies GH is an HI because each HI is a subgroup, right? That's what we're using in this step. We're using here. Implies GH is in the intersection, which is H. So that's it. Now I think maybe when we saw these two definitions of subgroup, right? We saw these two definitions of subgroup. One was it's a subset closed under multiplication and becomes a group in its own right, and the other was it's a subset closed under all three operations, right? And at the time, it wasn't clear which definition is better, right? It seemed like this one looks better, right? You're just saying it's closed in a multiplication. It's sort of, you're making weaker assumptions, whereas this one, you're making stronger assumptions. So you thought this one's better, right? But now you see from this, in this proof, the proof really looks nice because we chose the second definition, right? You just have three operations and it's closed under each of them. And that's sort of the reason when you looked at the two definitions of group, we had this one definition which just said there's only a multiplication, and then identity and inverses were part of the axioms, the conditions. And that definition said that the multiplication, identity, and inverse are all part of the group structure. Right? And at the time we were debating which one's better. But now we can see that the second definition has the advantage that this proof becomes really nice to write, right? And you can in fact see that somehow we didn't use anything about the operations, right? We could, even if it had like 20 other operations, you didn't have, you had, we could actually like think of this even more abstractly, right? We could just sort of think, oh, it's closed under all the operations, so the intersection's also in there, right? So in that sense, that's the power of that other definition. Helps us do these proofs more neatly. Okay.